engage our communities to impact change in perception and policy. 2008, she mobilized the African diaspora in the DMV to get out to vote. She's also has a marketing firm that's worked with clients such as the African Union, the National Geographic, National Urban League, and others. And she shares culture through music, song, dance, and drama as a member of the Mbutu of Uganda. Ladies and gentlemen, our speaker from Uganda, Julianne Kinganda. Round of applause, please.
Good afternoon, everyone.
Good afternoon.
Thank you all for being here. I know this is not necessarily a typical party, so for those who made it out on a Saturday afternoon, I commend you for being here. As I was introduced, my name is Julianne Kinganda. I'm president of African Diaspora for Change. I want to thank Sylvester for inviting me here, for the Lieutenant Governor for his wonderful remarks, and for making it a point for you to be here. I think that's really important for us to see in our community that we are supported by our elected officials, and we have to do a better job making sure that we are present and we show up in numbers. I want to talk to you a little bit about my background and how I got involved with this organization, African Diaspora for Change. In 2008, a number of us in the community realized that we had to get our organizations and our African communities mobilized during the campaign in order for Obama to win, that we were actually a very critical segment of that vote. So what we did was we mobilized all these different constituency groups. We had Ivorians for Obama, we had Sudanese for Obama, we had Somalis, Eritreans, Ethiopians, and we hosted happy hours mostly around D.C. People came from Virginia, from Maryland, and we, in the course of that time, I think it was from July to the election, November, we knocked on about 13,000 doors as an organization, a coalition. Many of us worked in Virginia during election day and got people out to vote, canvass, neighborhoods, phone banking, all of those things. Before that, I was actually very not involved in politics. I was born in Uganda, and we actually came here as diplomats, and my father worked for the embassy, and all we heard was politics. So I had nothing to do with politics until 2008, when we saw that we had a real opportunity to get someone in the White House to implement real change. And so in that course of being involved in getting out the vote and the election process, you know, I started understanding that many of us in our communities, I think for those of us that are here, we do understand there is a connection between being involved in the vote and actually, you know, getting mobilized and getting those things that benefit our communities. But I realized that very often we are not engaged, our communities are not engaged for different reasons. You know, many of us are working several jobs, sending money back home to our families. We have been turned off by the political process because some of us are here to escape some of those, you know, the negative impacts of the political process in some of our own home countries. And so very often there's a disconnect between what we get in our communities and the involvement that we have and should have as members and citizens and residents of the United States. And so in the course of 2009 up to now, the work that our organization has done, everything from hosting census forums to immigration workshops, and also working with very closely with the DC mayor's office on some of their initiatives, I realized that we have a lot of work to do, and the biggest part of that has to do with educating our communities. So for everyone that is here, you have a responsibility to educate your community about why it's important that we are engaged beyond the vote. So, you know, we got people out, we got them to vote in record numbers in our communities, but then what happened after the vote? People weren't engaged, we didn't hold people accountable, we did not continue to mobilize and speak with a united voice about the issues that concern our communities. So, for example, I worked with the DC mayor's office during the time that they were doing budget hearings last year. And so they were looking to get more money for the office. People will complain that, you know, the DC mayor's office, you know, what do? They haven't really seen an impact in their work in the community. And the challenge is, they are resource challenged. They don't have the funding to do the programs they'd like to do. How do these, you know, special interest groups or these organizations or offices within these governments get funding. The constituents have to ask for this funding. You have to show up. You have to show that these things matter to you. And so I went to the budget hearing, and during the hearing, before the hearing, I invited people to come and make sure we were present so that the DC Mayor's office and actually the council member who was responsible for that particular subcommittee on community affairs was Marion Barry. And you know, I said, you know, we need to show up. So I get there, and there were two other members of the DC Commission who were testifying about why we needed more funding in the budget. Do you know that the Office on Aging had about 40 people show up and testify about why the funding was important in their communities? They packed that room. When it came time for our office to speak on why we needed more funding, there were three of us testifying and three people from the staff who were there to advocate for more funding. That's a problem. Because then, you know, Marion Barry sitting there at the empty room is like, oh, okay, he was actually on the phone while we're testifying. So that tells you the lack of urgency that they see about giving us this funding. And I'll tell you, the Mayor's Office on African Affairs, their funding is 4% of the funding for the Office on Latino Affairs. Why is that? I think we can answer that question. We've seen that Latinos mobilize very well for their interests. You know, you have organizations like La Raza, the National Council of La Raza, you know, and that's not just Mexicans, not just Puerto Ricans. It's all of these Hispanic constituent groups that realize that unless we mobilize and unite in numbers, we are not going to have the impact, we're not going to get the resources, we're not going to get what we need for our communities. And so one of the things that we've decided to do as an organization, African Diaspora for Change, is that we're launching our Beyond the Vote initiative. And it's no mistake that we're launching it during the election year. I think many of you have seen in the news, especially in the past year or so, Africa and the diaspora is a very hot topic. And so that should tell you that we are important, but I don't think we realize just how much of an impact we can have if we decide that we are going to unite behind a common cause. And so I think this is the time, you know, we last year, the UN termed 2011 as the International Year for People of African Descent. How many of you knew that? Yeah. Just raise your hand. How many of you knew that? Okay, so maybe about 10% of the people are here, maybe 20%. But just the fact that not everyone in this room knew that tells you that there was nothing put behind that. You know, there were no resources, there was an announcement, but that was it. You know, and again, it's because they know, oh, well, we can give them that date, but, you know, nobody's going to say anything about it, and nobody did. So we've decided we're going to call this year the Year of African Ascent, which tells us that we have a real opportunity beyond the election. Yes, we can get mobilized during the election, but then what happens after November 4th or November 2nd? What year is the election? What day is the election this year?
November 2nd.
2nd. Okay. What happens after November 2nd? You know? People go, they say, I voted, you've done your job, and that's it. We cannot do that anymore. We have to continue to engage, we have to educate, we have to empower our communities, and the real work takes place in between elections. As you can see, we're starting to mobilize now for an election that's taking place in November. There's a reason for that. There's work that needs to happen to get the results that we're looking for in November. So our campaign is actually going to be our Beyond the Vote initiative that we're going to be partnering with the Continental African Leadership Council as a coalition member. The goal is to really get, you know, all these organizations, all of our communities, to understand why it's important to engage beyond the vote. And so we're looking at civic engagement and advocacy as a core part of that. You know, a story that Sylvester told me recently in his work that he does in the community, and I commend him because he does an incredible amount of work, but he was telling me about how he went to the elders in the Liberian community and was explaining to them about the whole civic engagement process, the election process, why it's important that, you know, we're engaged, how to do it, how to advocate for your interests. And, you know, they tell him when he's finished, well, nobody's ever told us this before. We didn't realize that that's what needs to happen for us to get what we need for our communities. And they tell him, well, you have our full support. Whatever you need, we're there. We will get our community behind you. And so we need to do more of that. Everyone that's here, it's up to us to educate our communities, to engage them. This information is going to help us get resources for our community. So the second part of our Beyond the Vote initiative is going to be focusing on immigration reform. And the reason for that is because, you know, very often when you think about immigration reform, you think about the Hispanic community. They've taken that, they've owned it. And again, it's because they've learned to mobilize together for their common interests. But I can guarantee every single person in this room has been impacted by immigration issues, whether it's a personal impact, whether it's your family, whether it's your friend, every single person in here. But again, if we are not advocating and saying, this is what we want to see for our communities, nobody's gonna listen. How many of you realize that this year, I think it's this year, but there's a motion on the table right now to get rid of the DV visa lottery program. Mm-hmm. And again, if we don't know that and we don't advocate for why they should keep that program, the lottery program was instituted in 1990 to help diversify the immigrants that were coming to the U.S. And so before the lottery program, you had about 2% of the immigrants that were coming that were African, of African descent, coming from Africa. Once they started the lottery program, that number went tenfold. And so that tells you that that has really benefited our communities. But again, if you don't realize that they're going to get rid of this program, we're not advocating on our own behalf to keep that program, you know, they're gonna, you're gonna see these things happen, you wonder why. So our job with this Beyond the Vote initiative is to really help connect the dots as to why to get engaged, why to, you know, mobilize our communities, and how it has an impact. So I hope that all of you, you know, once Election Day is over and you realize we've gotten Obama back in the White House, that you understand the work is just beginning. The work is just beginning. We have so much to do. And I really hope that every single one of you in here will talk to, we have several ADC members in here. I think we're all wearing our tags. You can talk to one of us if you're interested in becoming a coalition member. One of our goals with this initiative is to put out information. There is a real lack of information for a number of these issues. So we'll be setting up a website. If you decide to partner with us, your name will be on our website. We'll be putting out a toolkit. It's almost like a how to engage your communities, how to mobilize. And we'll be putting out resources and doing, you know, workshops around the community. We're making this a national initiative. Because our whole goal is to really get us talking with a united voice. We have a number of different organizations that are doing work, very good work in their community. So it's not to take away from that, but it's really to serve as a bridge to bring all of us together so that, you know, we're not just talking in pockets of 50 people here, 100 people here, 20 people there, but that we're really working together as a coalition to advocate on our own behalf for our interests and the interests of our brothers and sisters back home. So, you know, again, I commend Sylvester and the Continental African Leadership Council. I hope you will continue to support their efforts and get more people in this room. Tell them there doesn't need to be a party for them to be here on time. That's the other thing we need to change, our African time. Thank you very much.